Welcome back. We hope you enjoyed our last video in which we talked about the confusing and often mysterious collection of health problems that many people experience even before they are diagnosed with any form of diabetes. We asked you to leave a comment and tell us what keeps you up at night, what symptoms you may be experiencing that frustrate you and prevent you from feeling your best. We read through every one of your comments and saw a number of common health problems popping up over and over again. Many of you wrote that it's hard to lose weight, or that you've lost weight in the past and that it came back with a vengeance. Many of you wrote that you're suffering from high blood pressure and high cholesterol, two conditions which affect your cardiovascular system and are commonly treated with pharmaceutical medications. Some of you wrote that you get numbness, tingling, or pain in your hands and feet, a condition called peripheral neuropathy that can be very painful. And some of you wrote that you have kidney problems and are taking medication to prevent your kidneys from getting worse over time. One common problem that many of you mentioned in the comments was that you're sick of taking pills, especially when those pills cause other side effects that make you feel even worse. And last but not least, low energy. That one pops up all the time. Cyrus and I both felt zapped for energy after being diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, and both of us can tell you just how terrible it felt to wake up feeling like we needed another 10 hours of sleep.
Now here's the thing. It took us years to figure out that many of these problems are often related to each other, and that they're actually very common when living with any form of diabetes. Why? Well, let's go into detail about how your body works, just in case you fell asleep in high school biology class. Let's start with insulin. Contrary to popular belief, insulin is not your enemy. Many medical professionals and people living with diabetes erroneously point their finger at insulin, claiming that insulin will make you fat, that insulin will increase your cholesterol level, and that insulin will increase your risk for diabetes. Here are two important things to know about insulin. Number one, insulin is absolutely necessary for life. If insulin were not present in your body at all, you would die in a short period of time, likely within weeks or months. Number two, insulin itself does not raise your risk for chronic disease. Excess insulin beyond your normal physiological level is what sets the stage for many chronic diseases over the course of time. Your dog secretes insulin. Your neighbor's cat secretes insulin. Your non-diabetic coworker secretes insulin. Insulin is an absolutely essential biological hormone that is secreted by beta cells in all mammals and is a critical hormone that is mandatory for life. Without insulin, your dog would die. Your neighbor's cat would die. Your coworker would, yeah, die. Without insulin, the cells in your liver, in your muscles, and in your fat tissue would have a very difficult time recognizing that glucose is present in your blood, resulting in chronically high blood glucose at all times. So think of insulin as an escort for glucose that tells cells and tissues all over your body, hey, glucose is available in the blood. Would you like to take some inside? When insulin knocks on the door of cells inside tissues all over your body, they're given the opportunity to import glucose from your blood if and only if they have the ability to recognize insulin's presence. Where you run into trouble is when cells in your liver, in your muscle, in your pancreas, and in your adipose tissue fail to recognize insulin's signal, which then results in tissues rejecting large amounts of glucose and rejecting insulin at the same time. So what causes cells in your body to reject insulin in the first place? Well, even though people will tell you that carbohydrates are dangerous, understand that carbohydrates are not the enemy, especially if they originate from whole plant foods. Carbohydrates were never the enemy, and carbohydrates will never be the enemy. On the contrary, fatty acids directly inhibit the action of insulin, and the amount of fat that you eat and the type of fat that you eat are the primary determinants of how insulin resistant you become over the course of time. That's right. The more fat you consume, especially saturated fat, the more insulin resistant you become. All you have to do is remember this one thing. Insulin resistance is caused by the accumulation of excess fat in tissues that are not designed to store large quantities of fat. When you eat fatty foods, even if they come from plants like avocados, nuts and seeds, coconuts or olives, these lipids get inside of your blood within 30 to 60 minutes. These fatty acids travel through your entire body and route to tissues like your muscle, like your liver, like your pancreas, your kidney, and even your heart. Unfortunately, cells don't have sophisticated mechanisms to block large amounts of fatty acids from entering when they are present in your blood in high amounts. In effect, the more fat you eat, the more fat you force tissues to take up. Now, your muscles and liver are specifically designed to remain lean with only small amounts of fatty acids in lipid droplets at all times. But because these tissues absorb nutrients that appear in your blood, they remain unprotected against large influxes of fatty acids that occur in the hours following a fat-rich meal. So when cells in your liver and muscles begin burning and storing fatty acids, they block glucose from entering because the cellular machinery required to uptake, process, and store glucose has been deprioritized. In effect, your muscles and liver say, hey, let me process this fatty acid stuff first, then I can deal with glucose later. So within hours of a single high-fat meal, insulin receptors become less numerous and less functional. They perform less work, and they have a very difficult time recognizing insulin in your blood. These dysfunctional insulin receptors keep glucose outside of cells, leaving glucose trapped in your blood for long periods of time. Then, when you check your blood glucose 2 to 6 hours after a meal containing predominantly fat and protein with a small or a medium amount of carbohydrate, you may see a high number and you might ask yourself, well, why is my blood glucose high? I didn't even eat that much carbohydrate. And that's exactly when insulin rejection first takes place. Unlike your adipose tissue, which is specifically designed to store fat and protect other organs from fat overload, your muscle and liver are designed to store small amounts of fat, only small amounts, and large amounts of glucose as this stuff called glycogen. But when your liver and muscles first absorb fat from your blood following a fat-rich meal, they respond by blocking or rejecting insulin in order to block glucose from entering, because they've already taken on fatty acids as their primary energy source. In effect, first come, first served. In addition to your muscles, your liver is a crucial part of this insulin resistance equation, because cells in your liver are capable of exporting glucose into your blood to provide your brain with a constant supply of glucose at all times. Now here's the problem. When you develop insulin resistance in your liver due to the accumulation of too much fat, your liver can't communicate with insulin very effectively, resulting in a high rate of glucose export, a high fasting blood glucose, and high post-meal blood glucose. In effect, the accumulation of excess fatty acids prevents your liver from accurately controlling how much glucose it takes up and how much it releases into your blood. Now, beta cells in your pancreas are particularly sensitive to fatty acids because they have a limited ability to protect themselves against damage. And when they're exposed to high fat concentrations for long periods of time, their antioxidant defense mechanisms are inadequate to protect them against dysfunction. The result of chronic beta cell stress turns into beta cell suicide. And when exposed to high concentrations of fatty acids, beta cells undergo this process known as apoptosis, or programmed cell death. It's at this point of no return that's the equivalent of saying, hey, listen, we can't take it anymore. We've tried for a long time. And when large populations of beta cells undergo apoptosis, insulin production rapidly falls below its normal physiologically level. And that's a real problem. Now here's the good news. If you significantly reduce your level of whole body insulin resistance, the remaining beta cell population often produces sufficient insulin to meet the demands of all tissues. Even when your beta cell mass has been significantly compromised, the remaining beta cell population is often capable of producing sufficient insulin for all tissues, but only if you take the steps to reduce your body's insulin needs by increasing your insulin sensitivity.
Now here's the good news. If you're living with pre-diabetes or type 2 diabetes, then you can easily and quickly set yourself up for success. For example, take Raj, who lost more than 60 pounds, reversed fatty liver disease, lowered his triglycerides, lowered his cholesterol, and reversed type 2 diabetes. And if you're living with type 1 diabetes like Cyrus and I are, then trust us, you're likely to reduce your insulin use big time while eating more carbohydrate-rich foods and feel more energy than you felt in a long time. Take Chris as an example. When Chris started the Mastering Diabetes Method, he had been living with type 1 diabetes for 57 years. In addition to other chronic health problems, including rheumatoid arthritis, high cholesterol, high blood pressure, and depression. Over the course of 1 year, Chris lost more than 80 pounds, cut his insulin use by half, reversed rheumatoid arthritis, mind you, which Western medicine classifies as irreversible, and eliminated not one, not two, but 11 pharmaceutical medications. He's no longer depressed, his blood pressure is normal, his cholesterol is normal, and he's the happiest he's been in years. That's what happens when you address the root cause and stop trying to fix the symptoms of diabetes. That's the magic of reversing insulin resistance using your food as medicine.
Now you might be thinking, okay, great. Of course I want great health, but changing my diet is gonna require a lot of work. To that we say true and false. It's true because your lifestyle certainly won't change without your effort, but it's false because changing your habits doesn't have to be complicated and it doesn't have to be hard. And if you follow the Mastering Diabetes Method exactly as we describe, you can make simple step-by-step changes and work at your own pace. The goal is to make it so that your new habits literally prevent you from making suboptimal decisions. And if you make incremental changes, small pieces at a time, you can't help but transform your entire lifestyle in a short period of time. Another thing we hear people say all the time is that they're too busy for lifestyle change and that they don't have the time to do it. And that maybe sometime in the future I'll do it. To that we say, there is no time like the present. Why? Well, because the minute you start feeling more energy, or the minute you start to see your blood glucose begin to drop, or the minute you begin losing weight predictably and reliably, you'll likely be so encouraged that you'll ask yourself why you didn't start years ago. You might think that there's gonna be a better time to prioritize your health in the future, but the truth is that the perfect time never presents itself. No matter when you think it's a better time to change your lifestyle, when that time approaches, you'll likely find another excuse that keeps you from committing. And trust us, living with insulin resistance, any version of diabetes, or any cardiovascular condition is expensive if you don't take matters into your own hands as soon as possible. Take it from me. I spend only 10% of what I used to spend on insulin, on medical equipment, and on doctor's appointments. And that's helped me save tremendous amounts of money and my personal sanity in the process. The best time to change your lifestyle is now. And as soon as you commit, you'll understand exactly why there truly is no time like the present. So how do you start? It's actually quite simple. Click on the button below this video and take the insulin resistance quiz. All you have to do is answer a few simple questions, then we'll help you understand your level of baseline insulin resistance and teach you how you can take the steps to become the healthiest that you've been in years. So click below, take the quiz, and we'll see you in the next video.